10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Today on Studio One, the new school year means new guidelines for the H1N1 virus. Find out what some schools are doing to prepare for a swine flu outbreak. Also, many people enjoy camping, but not usually outside of a building. Find out what reward these college students are camping out for. And all it takes are a few mosquitoes to ruin an outside evening. We'll tag along with a man who keeps an eye on how many of these potentially dangerous pests are bothering his community.
From the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, this is Studio One.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Studio One. I'm Monty Cashel.
And I'm Amy Anra.
And a special welcome to two new cities who are joining us as viewers, Devil's Lake, North Dakota, and Colorado Springs, Colorado.
Yeah, welcome.
And we have a lot of great things lined up for you on today's show. One of them is we're going to be talking to a researcher who is bucking the trend a little bit on things we've been hearing for quite a long time about how seafood is actually good for people.
Yeah, like with pregnant women, they're not supposed to eat a lot of seafood.
Exactly, because the FDA said mercury levels can be high, so maybe stay away. Well, he's found some interesting things that could go against that a little bit, so we'll talk to him later and find out the details. Also, school supplies consist of crayons, paper, and now hand sanitizer. Find out what steps schools are taking to prevent the swine flu.
Also, abuse affects between 600,000 and 6 million people in the United States. Counselors say only a fraction of those people seek help. Later in the show, we'll talk with someone who educates people about abuse.
But first, here's today's news with Dylan Wollenhaus.
Thanks, Monty and Amy. The world may be one step closer to ridding itself of the threat of a nuclear war. On Thursday, President Obama led a meeting of the UN Security Council. The gathering focused on stopping the spread of nuclear weapons. Obama addressed Russia, China, Great Britain, and France, urging them to adopt stricter controls on nuclear materials. Obama says the resolution, which passed unanimously, will make it harder to steal these materials or use them for warfare. The summit is the first Security Council gathering chaired by a U.S. president. After fighting the epidemic for over a quarter of a century, we now have a breakthrough in the search for an HIV/AIDS vaccine. In 2003, Thailand tested an experimental vaccine on 16,000 volunteers ages 18 to 30. Results of the trial now show that the vaccine may lower the chance of infection by one-third. More research is needed, but developers say the study is a major step toward a vaccine that was once thought impossible. Blood banks often have a tough time getting you to donate blood. Many times it leaves them trying new ways to attract donors by giving away t-shirts or coupons. Now some blood banks are offering a bigger incentive. United Blood Services of the City of Fargo and the City of Fargo, North Dakota have teamed up to create Your Ticket to Donate program. They allow people a one-time credit of $20 off their speeding ticket if they're willing to donate blood. Traffic violators have 14 days after getting a ticket to contact the blood bank, but some say this incentive to donate blood may not be the best approach.
The real question is whether or not those people will become regular repeat donors as to whether or not the incentive is something that will really assist the blood bank.
United Blood Services says the program has started off slower than expected. Those who attempt to donate but do not qualify will still receive the credit. To save on energy costs, you might find yourself shutting off some extra lights in your house. And in tough economic times, many cities are doing the same thing with street lights. Some public officials say street lights just create light pollution and burn extra energy instead of being a helpful safety measure. Some towns are charging fees to reduce the cost. More than 30 towns in Minnesota have already added a $2.25 street light fee to utility bills. In an effort to save $400,000 a year on energy costs, the city of Santa Rosa, California is removing over one-third of their street lights. With the school year in full swing, the typical worries of finding a classroom or remembering a locker combination are all there, but the threat of swine flu has some schools taking some extra steps to prevent an outbreak.
At Red River High School in Grand Forks, North Dakota, the school year begins, just like any other,
You know, it's on everybody's mind and the topic is out there.
But a new worry is on the horizon. Swine flu.
What's different about this is that we don't have any background immunity.
6 months to 24 years old is the prime area, and we've got all those school-age kids in our building.
In an effort to beat the flu, the Grand Forks School District bought hand sanitizer for each one of these classrooms, developed a special code for their computer system identifying if a certain student has the flu, and sent letters to each parent giving tips for their children, like washing hands, covering your mouth when you cough, and it's these simple things that experts say will keep you healthy if practiced.
I know we all want to do that, go to work, go to school, do those types of things, but you're not doing your body a favor and you're not doing your friends a favor when you do that. You just promote that illness amongst a lot more people.
The Centers for Disease Control's website states a vaccine should be out earlier than expected, but still not until early October, and students may not even have to go to a clinic to get the shot.
I think that decision will be made at our district level, but I wouldn't be surprised if they made that option available in the schools.
Leaving teachers and their students riding out the potential threat of the virus, using safe practices, hoping they can make perfect.
Now, if your kids are showing any flu-like symptoms, schools ask that they stay home at least 24 hours, get checked out by a doctor, and of course, call ahead for any missed assignments. We'll have more news for you later in the show. Monty and Amy.
Thanks, Dylan. Well, that's one thing you can count on is flu season, right?
Yeah, and when the seasons change, that kind of comes. But actually, this fall, we've had a beautiful fall.
We have.
And so how about we go to the weather studio with Erin Burchy, and she'll tell us a little bit about why it's been so nice this season.
Thanks, Monty and Amy. It has been pretty nice this fall season. There hasn't been too much going on this past week with weather, actually. If we take a look at the weather map, we're going to see there's just this high pressure sitting right over the Rocky Mountains. And high pressures are usually associated with that nice weather, not very many clouds, a lot of sun, and pretty nice temperatures because the highs suck up all the moisture in the atmosphere. And they just kind of keep them there for themselves. And what highs do is they move towards lows. But as you can see from this surface map, the low is not moving very much. It's moving a little bit here and there, but not too much. And this high pressure system can't move too as long as that low pressure system moves. Because of this, there's been some downpours in Atlanta, Georgia, and that kind of thing with the stationary front, which is attached to this low pressure system, which we have pictured right here. It's two conflicting air masses pretty much. You got a cold air mass and a warm air mass, and they're just not moving. The wind isn't moving them. Nothing is moving them. And when you have it sitting there like that, you get a lot of rain, a lot of clouds, especially down into Atlanta, Georgia. They're having some flooding down there. We'll take a look at that later on in the show. But like I said, a lot of rain with these systems. They don't really move, so they just keep raining. With our wet and dry, looks like they're going to be getting some relief down into Atlanta and out on the East Coast. It's going to be a lot drier out there, but on into the central portions of the nation, looks like we're going to be pretty wet going into next week, possibly some showers here and there for us here in the Midwest. Around the region for our warm and cold, cold up into Washington, that area up into the northwestern parts of the state, and down into Texas, we're going to be seeing warmer temperatures. They're going to be a little bit higher than average temperatures down there. Later on in our show, we're going to be taking a look at Atlanta, Georgia, and they're flooding, like I said, because of that stationary front. And we're also going to be looking at a new renewable energy resource that's causing problems for meteorologists. So our weather question this week, which state has the highest wind energy potential? Answers there, Montana, Kansas, Texas, and North Dakota. They're actually the highest, top four states for wind here in the U.S.
Oh, wow. And so I noticed, Erin, that they're all kind of in the middle of the country. Is there a reason for that?
Yep. Actually, there isn't very many trees, any mountains, that kind of thing blocking anything. They're actually flat plains, so it causes the wind to move a little bit faster over the flat plains.
Wow. Okay, great. Thanks, Erin.
Yep.
All right.
Well, it certainly is windy here.
Yeah, faster winds over the plains.
Mm-hmm.
We know that. Okay, it's time now to go to sports highlights, and Eric Swanson has those.
Thanks, Monty and Amy. With a little under 10 games remaining in the regular season, most Major League Baseball teams already know their playoff fate. But once again, the American League Central is providing fans with a race that could come down to the last game. To Cleveland now, where the Tigers are up 2 already in the top of the first. When Lou Marson misplays the throw to the plate, the Tigers have a big lead to start the game, but Detroit wasn't done yet. Their bats have awoken, and Carlos Guillen hits a moonshot to the right field stands. Detroit would take an 8-1 lead into the fifth inning, and now they're just toying with the Indians. Guillen hits his second home run of the night, and from there, the Tigers continue to pile on. They score 2 more runs, and more importantly, stay in the win column. with second place Minnesota nipping at their heels for the division crown. The Twins would play in Chicago later that evening. They got out to a great start. Top of the fourth, Carlos Gomez sneaks an RBI double down the line. The Twins lead by five. Now in the seventh, Twins only up by one until Nick Punto knocks in two more runs. Minnesota lead goes to three. Jermaine Dye would cut the Twins lead in half with a late home run, but that's all the Sox had. Twins go on to sweep Chicago and keep pace with Detroit in the American League Central. Many teams focus on their opponent's strengths and weaknesses. Now they may have to start focusing on their jersey color as well. Experts say the color red may benefit the competitor wearing it. The color can give a team extra confidence while their opponent may feel intimidated.
And just wearing a certain color uniform, an athlete could go in, it could raise their confidence. I can beat them because they're wearing yellow. You know, and red, of course, always comes out as the strongest. Teams that wear red are more associated with being a winning team.
Players aren't the only ones who are affected by the color. Schortz says spectators and referees are affected by the sight of different colors as well. A recent study by a university in Germany says that refs can sometimes favor red teams. They found teams can score up to 10% more in a competition while wearing red. It's now time for the Studio One Sports Trivia Question. We want to know which Major League Baseball team completed the biggest comeback to reach the playoffs. We got four choices there, all the way from a team from 1914 to as recently as 1995. We'll give you a chance to think that over, and we'll get back to you later in the show. That's the sports. Monty and Amy.
Thanks a lot, Eric. A new movie shows a future where people never leave their home, but still are able to enjoy every sensation. We'll preview the movie, Surrogates.
Also, North Dakota recently changed its laws regarding strangulation. Until 2 years ago, it was not recognized as a criminal offense. We'll talk to an abuse educator about this law, and she'll give us some tips on how to prevent domestic abuse.
Many people have ideas. An entrepreneur takes an idea from the drawing board to the boardroom. The University of North Dakota's College of Business and Public Administration offers a nationally ranked entrepreneurship program. Students put business ideas into action. An engineering student develops software for unmanned aircraft systems. UND's entrepreneurship program equipped him with the skills to launch his business plan. UND's College of Business and Public Administration. See where your ideas can take you.
Hand with a caring touch can make a difference. The University of North Dakota College of Nursing now offers a program to meet the healthcare needs of older adults and patients with chronic illnesses. Earn your Master's of Science degree online as a gerontological nurse practitioner or a clinical nurse specialist.
Our program being all online has both innovation and human touch. Practice in hospitals and clinics, nursing homes, home care.
Continue to work and study in your community while advancing your healthcare career.
At the University of North Dakota School of Engineering and Mines, I can experience education that fits my goals.
Become a competitive graduate in a global market and learn in small class sizes where professors are also mentors.
Work in a diverse team and inspire young minds.
Help develop world-class research.
Gain state-of-the-art technical knowledge while building strong business and leadership skills.
And stay connected even after I graduate.
The University of North Dakota is a place where students thrive, where personal connections matter, where classmates become friends, where leading scholars become mentors. Experience our expertise. Creative, innovative, entrepreneurial, spirited. This is the University of North Dakota.
You're watching Studio One, your source for news, weather, sports, and entertainment.
In North Dakota alone, there are over 4,000 domestic abuse cases reported each year. but the actual amount of cases is expected to be much higher than that. Abuse prevention and education specialist STACI RUTHERFORD is here to tell us about this common form of violence.
Well, thank you for coming on the show.
You're welcome.
Yeah. So how big is domestic violence a problem in the nation?
You know, domestic violence truly is a widespread problem. There has been studies done, and on average, 3 women are killed per day by the hands of an intimate partner. And we know that about 85% of victims are female, and then 15% are male. So it's definitely an issue that we see across the nation.
Okay, and so what are the more common forms of abuse?
I would say one of the common forms of abuse would be that emotional abuse, putting a person down, making them feel bad about themselves, isolating them from their friends, family, activities that they do enjoy to do. We see some physical violence. We do see, using their children, different tactics to keep that power and control in that relationship.
Okay, and something that we talked to each other about before is strangulation laws changing. Mm-hmm. Why has that changed?
I think we've started to realize how dangerous strangulation can be. It takes a very minimal amount of pressure and a very minimal amount of time to do a lot of damage to a person.
Okay, and so why would somebody want to stay in an abusive relationship rather than just leaving?
It's a very difficult question to answer. Some of our thoughts are, why it's difficult for a person to leave a relationship really is out of that danger and fear. They've probably been told over and over that if you leave me, I'm going to hurt you. If you leave me, I'm going to hurt myself. If you leave me, I'm going to take the kids. So there's a lot of threats that come into play with a person leaving. So the biggest reason is out of that danger and fear. There's a lot of barriers that a person experiences as they're trying to leave a relationship, for such as economics. How am I going to afford? How am I going to afford to live? How am I going to afford to keep my children safe? Where can I go? They don't know what resources are really available to them. And they really, truly love this person. The domestic violence really doesn't happen the first date, the first month. It's usually something that happens over time. And when they're ready to leave and they have decided that it's safe enough for them to leave, they will hope for the change that this person will be the person that they once fell in love with.
Okay, and so how about with the opposite situation? Sometimes people are stuck with their partner saying, if you leave me, I'm going to kill myself. How mm-hmm. do you handle that type of situation?
We really leave the choices up to the victims. We really want them to be empowered because it's really the victim who knows their safety the best. So in that situation, if they would seek out services from an agency, we would hope that they're maybe looking at that safety planning. What are some safe places? What are safe options? Can I have a purse that's ready to go? Do I have a cell phone that I can contact 911 right away? So there's a lot of things, and we know that it can be really frustrating for people who are friends of someone who is trying to leave a relationship, but we know that every time they go back to that person, maybe they're putting the pieces together, they're trying to get everything for it, so it is safe for them to leave that relationship.
Okay, and with these violent situations, how would somebody judge whether or not they should leave?
I think that's really up to the victim. Like I've kind of mentioned, the victim is the best person to know their own safety. So we would want the victim to assess when it's safe for them to leave. It could be 2:00 in the morning. It could be while that person was at work. It's just really basically up to that victim.
Okay, and so how often would a person go back to a violent partner?
They say on average a person would go back 7 times. And in that 7 times, once again, maybe they're picking up the pieces. They've been threatened that they would get their children taken away. So they're going back, to make sure that doesn't happen. So then in the meantime, they can get that maybe legal advice, or they can go contact services from somewhere, just so then they can have everything put into place so when they do decide that they're ready to leave, that everything is safe and hopefully it's a successful attempt to leave.
Okay, and so what are some of the reasons for domestic violence?
I think one of the biggest reasons we hear is that somebody has made a choice to be violent, so they made a choice on what type of violence they're going to use. We use what's called the power and control wheel, and that gives different tactics that an abuser uses. But it's definitely a choice someone has made. Maybe if they witnessed violence as they were growing up, or at their school they saw bullying, or they were once bullied. It could be experience and reinforcement. I learned over time that if I continue being abusive to this person or use one of those tactics, I will get what I want when I want it.
Okay, and so what would be some of your best advice that you would give somebody who is in a violent or bad situation?
I think the best advice I could give to a person would be that there is help available. contact a local agency. Right here in Grand Forks, we have a domestic violence sexual assault agency. Most cities, you know, or most people have access to one. If not, there is a 1-800 domestic violence hotline that you can call, and they will connect you with the nearest domestic violence shelter or domestic violence agency. But I think the biggest piece I can give is, you know, if you need that help, there is always help available, and don't be afraid to reach out for that help.
Okay, well, great. Thank you so much for coming on the show, Stacy.
Thank you.
Coming up, every sports team has diehard fans. We'll show you what some hockey fans are willing to endure in order to see the puck drop. Also, those little bloodsuckers can be deadly. We'll tell you about a man who helps his community stay free of mosquitoes and, in turn, the West Nile virus.
Studio One closed captioning is underwritten in part by Options, your disability information source.
For almost 120 years, graduate education has been a focus at the University of North Dakota, and the humanities has been the cornerstone of our liberal arts tradition since the first advanced degree was awarded in 1895. Today, the graduate school continues to build on the success of this tradition by offering exceptional opportunities in the humanities. Seize the opportunity for an advanced degree in the humanities. Contact the graduate school at UND today.
University of North Dakota is a place where students thrive, where graduates succeed, where ideas are born, and research is driven by imagination. Experience our expertise. Creative, innovative, entrepreneurial, spirited. This is the University of North Dakota.
Remember where you met your best friends? Where you discovered your passions? Celebrate the past by supporting UND's future. The University of North Dakota Alumni Association connects you with people who have touched your life. They engage you in the university community and campus events. Help the University of North Dakota grow by becoming involved with your alma mater. The University of North Dakota Alumni Association. Connect. Engage. Grow.
Today, we control computers. In the science fiction movie Surrogates, the computers control us. Bruce Willis stars as an FBI agent in this futuristic film. In the movie, robots are made to look exactly like their human controllers. The robots experience the outside world for them. People can stay safely at home. When the first murder in years happens, it's up to Willis's character to solve the mysterious crime. He abandons his robot lifestyle and uncovers a conspiracy that could put all human life in danger.
Surrogacy, I think it doesn't sound that bad. I mean, you just get to stay home in a chair that hopefully has a massage sort of vibration aspect to it, and this super sexy version of yourself gets to go out and live your life for you.
There is another group that is rebelling against surrogacy and the fact that everybody's just gone surrogate crazy. And so that's where the murder mystery comes in.
The film is based on popular graphic novels and inspired by today's obsession with realistic gaming. Surrogates opens in theaters September 25th. Now it's time to look at the events happening in your area. It is peak season for West Nile virus. One group is attacking the disease at the source. Today we'll spend a night in the life of a mosquito sprayer.
It's dusk in Grand Forks, North Dakota, and a strange sound is disturbing the quiet streets. Tonight, conditions are just right for mosquito sprayers like Todd Hansen to battle the bugs in hopes of keeping these blood-sucking insects at bay.
You know, there we're at the mercy of the weather. And if we don't have good conditions, once the temperature drops, insect activity really drops down.
Todd's chemical kills mosquitoes on contact that could potentially be carrying a deadly virus.
You know, it was really West Nile virus in 2002 that made me decide that this was going to be a career for me.
Todd has been keeping these bothersome bugs in check for 14 years, which makes some wonder how many times he's been bitten.
Oh, no idea.
Despite all of the red itchy bumps, Todd finds the rewards of his work in the data.
North Dakota, you know, Grand Forks County, by far has the lowest number of human West Nile virus cases.
Dog walkers and picnic goers alike have noticed.
Right now, the mosquitoes aren't too bad. It's not too muggy out, so it could be a lot worse, but you know, hopefully it stays like this.
Not too bad at all, actually. I remember last year, there was a lot of mosquitoes out, but this year it's been pretty good.
So at the end of the night, just as quickly as they roared in, the echoing sounds of the sprayers drift away. I'm Jason Chiotti reporting for Studio One.
Todd has a tip to protect yourself from West Nile virus. He says to use an effective mosquito spray containing DEET. Coming up, wind farms are an abundant source of energy, but they can cause a problem. Find out what trouble these turbines are stirring up for meteorologists. That story plus news, sports, and weather in the next half hour of Studio One.
Closed captioning for Studio One is underwritten in part by NDAD, helping others to help themselves.
It's a place to diddly bop shop, put shopping into overdrive. A great place to wine and dine, make a taste for jump and dive. Yeah, it's great in Grand Forks, a great destination. Great in Grand Forks, they don't call it Grand for nothing.
Studio One is a television show produced by staff and students at the University of North Dakota. Here you actually get to do your own stories and you get to go out and talk to people and interview and learn about the cameras and everything that goes into like a live television production. I mean, it's incredible.
Give it a try. I mean, even if you're not broadcasting, communications major, anything, I mean, it's worth it.
The play is under review.
Hey, take a look at this.
This online course is awesome.
Yeah, I gotta see that again.
A skilled hand with a caring touch can make a difference. The University of North Dakota College of Nursing now offers a program to meet the healthcare needs of older adults and patients with chronic illnesses. Earn your Master's of Science degree online as a gerontological nurse practitioner or a clinical nurse specialist.
Our program being all online has both innovation and human touch. Practice in hospitals and clinics, nursing homes, home care.
Continue to work and study in your community while advancing your healthcare career.
From the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Thanks for joining us today.
When people commit violent crimes, a lot of times they'll end up with sentences like life in prison or maybe even death row. Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of you probably remember the Manson family that are famous for a lot of their murders.
Back in the late 60s, I believe it was.
Yep. Well, one of them is actually, she went up for parole because she has a terminal illness.
Okay, so she went up for parole. Was she denied or did she get it?
She was denied. Okay. And so we want to know your thoughts on about whether these people should be kept in prison or let out because of this.
Because of their terminal illness. Interesting. I'm sure we'll have some interesting answers. Also coming up in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, college students are turning to a familiar place when the job market is tough. We'll show you what students are doing to better their chances of employment.
Also, 2 years ago, one small town school was destroyed by a tornado. The community has rebuilt, and we'll tell you how they're adjusting.
And books, studying, and classes help make people more intelligent. We'll talk to a scientist who thinks that fish should be added to that list. But first, here's today's news with Dylan Wollenhaus.
Thanks, Monty and Amy. Germany's federal election is Sunday, but many Germans are now more alarmed about another issue. A member from Al-Qaeda has posted a video threat on the internet threatening an attack on the country. In the video, a man states if parties that are voted in do not pledge to pull German troops from Afghanistan, there will be a rude awakening. He then warns Muslims in the country to hide out for the next 2 weeks after the elections, implying any attacks would be taking place around the election time. The same day the video was posted, the German government reacted by raising its own alert level and heightening security. U.S. officials are warning American citizens in Germany to be aware of their surroundings and to keep a low profile. Officials with the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals made one of the biggest animal rescues in the nation's history on Wednesday. Over 1,000 animals were found in a small home. The residents say they were breeding them to sell in flea markets. Rescuers say the animals were living in unsanitary conditions. Some of the animals include turtles, dogs, chickens, and snakes, and officials say they all lack food, water, and proper shelter. Police transported the animals to a shelter, and they will soon be put up for adoption. Some people think visiting the organic section in your local grocery store can be expensive, but a healthy part of your diet. But that rise in your grocery bill might not equal the rise in your health benefits. A recent study shows that the extra 50% that some pay for organic fruits and vegetables might not be worth it. The study by the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition shows organic foods have no nutritional or health benefits over conventionally produced foods. But even if the foods aren't more nutritious, some of the other benefits are
going organic. Seems to be a hot topic these days just because of a lot of food recalls that have been going on. And that hasn't been going on as much with the organic food just because they don't have as high a risk of contamination.
To be labeled an organic food, it must be grown using natural fertilization instead of chemicals and pesticides. Experts say that the sales of organic food in the U.S. have grown by almost 16% in the last year. For the first time in history, women are filling the majority of job markets in the workforce. Recent numbers from the Bureau of Labor Statistics show that in June, women were holding nearly 50% of jobs in the nation. Experts say women will pass that mark as early as October if the current pace remains. Many point to the recession for the decline of male workers. And over 6 million jobs have been erased since the December of 2007, and 75% of those belong to men. Job markets like construction and manufacturing that traditionally hire men are declining, and jobs are growing in education and healthcare, which are normally dominated by women. Having a college degree is a must for getting almost any job. This year has students seeking a new opportunity in an economy that is keeping the job force locked for many graduates.
As the leaves change colors and the temperatures drop, students across the country are settling in for another year at college. This year, however, the turning of the seasons is not the only change on campuses.
I guess the deciding factor was I didn't expect to find a job in my field upon graduation this year, so I really thought, you know, going to grad school for a couple years would improve my chances.
And graduate school is a place where students are looking for a way into a job market that's keeping them out.
The economy is competitive right now, probably as competitive as I've seen it since the early 2000s.
But waiting to enter the workforce may not always be the best course.
There are higher pay benefits that go with advanced degrees. But the risk is you're competing with a more experienced job force.
Experts say students should prepare for the job market after college in advance.
By starting early, they can have the tools in their tool chest that they need.
So you need to think of it along the lines of, where do you see yourself in 10 years or maybe 20 years?
Although there's no clear-cut answer for new college grads looking for jobs, Many are expecting that enrolling in graduate school,
it'll pay off in the end, hopefully.
For Studio One News, I'm Haley Venzel.
What you see on screen.
According to the National Graduate Council, the 2007-2008 school year saw a near 5% increase in graduate student enrollment. The final numbers for the graduate students in 2009 will not be released until November, but schools like the University of Illinois, the University of North Dakota, and Michigan Tech have all reported an increase. And that's the news. Monty and Amy.
Thanks a lot, Dylan. Well, I guess, you can't go wrong by going back to school.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, and in the school years, it comes the fall, and we're having a great fall this year.
It's been beautiful.
Yeah, but they're not so lucky down south. They're having a lot of flooding. Mm-hmm. So how about we go to the weather studio with Erin Birchie, and she'll tell us about that.
They are having a lot of flooding down there, Monty and Amy. It's not starting to get better, though, but it's still flooding down into Atlanta, Georgia. If you take a look at some of this footage that we have here, they have a lot of flooding. Backyards are being flooded. Front yards aren't. A lot of decks are being covered up, a lot of water damages to homes and all that kind of stuff. There's actually been 10 people killed who have been swept away in their cars. The president has promised that relief is on its way and the waters are starting to recede, but there is $250 million in damages. This is where Atlanta, Georgia is located. As you can see, it's in the northern part of the state, and northwest of that is where the Chattahoochee River is, and that is what's flooding. Most of the state still has those flood warnings out there from the National Weather Service, and they're still going to keep those out there until they get clearance that the stage levels have gone down. But one thing the National Weather Service, when they aren't dealing with weather disasters, they're getting tricked by a new renewable energy resources and the tools that make it possible to have this new renewable resource.
Turbines rotate with the wind, creating an alternative, clean, and reliable form of energy. Wind farms are being used more often in the transition of finding new sources of power.
So how could such a positive technology possibly affect us negatively?
The wind farms do produce a radar return signal.
Wind farms can interfere with radar. These signals appear from the massive spinning blades on the tower's 200 feet tall. They can show up on Doppler radar looking like a violent storm or even a tornado. This demands more skill out of all forecasters.
It can make it a little more challenging at some times.
However, forecasters can use techniques that help them see which weather is truly severe and which is only seen as a windy day.
Meteorologists look at higher levels to see if that signal persists or not at the upper levels to determine if it's a thunderstorm or just the wind farm.
Even though the turbines show up on radar, forecasters put in a lot of effort to not confuse that with actual severe weather. So the next time a storm blows over, they will not throw caution into the wind and accurately detect what's out there. I'm Joe Hansel, reporting for Studio One Weather.
One example that has happened in the National Weather Service in Kansas was actually a false tornado signature on the radar, and the National Weather Service did issue a tornado warning, but there was no severe weather around that. So it can be problems for meteorologists, but it can be good for the nation, especially when it comes to energy and the cost of it. Back to our weather question this week, which state has the highest energy potential? The answer is North Dakota. And North Dakota actually has the power or has enough wind energy to produce over 40% of the energy needed for the United States.
Wow, well, I certainly can agree with that with the wind. Thanks, Erin.
Yep.
40%?
We can do a lot of stuff with 40% of that energy.
Build some windmills, I guess.
Yeah,
okay.
It's blustery, though.
Well, it's time now again to turn to sports news, and Eric Swanson has that.
Thanks, Monty and Amy. Sports fans go to great lengths to support their favorite team, but it takes a special breed of fan to do what students in Grand Forks did in order to see their team in action. The plains of North Dakota. It's here where some say the most diehard sports fans congregate.
It's just the atmosphere. Everyone loves it. Crazy fans. They love everything about it.
It's like a cult out here, to be honest. I mean, they just bleed it.
Fans of the University of North Dakota Fighting Sioux hockey team are willing to wait in line.
Probably about 20 hours.
For a chance to purchase season tickets.
Fighting Sioux hockey, you got to get the Minnesota game, the Wisconsin game, the Denver game, the Mankato game. You got to get them all. Just got to be there for it because you don't want to be that guy that wasn't there.
One guy that certainly will be there.
Number one.
Is the guy that beat everyone else to the front of the line.
Oh, I'm going to frame this wristband.
Fans like Gage came surprisingly well prepared for the long night ahead of them.
There's games everywhere. We got Polish golf, we got bags, there's footballs being thrown around. Everyone's having a great time.
The fans didn't have to wait until the first puck drops to see their favorite team either. Students got a chance to meet many players while they set up camp for the night.
We've just been going around talking to people and kind of just mingling in and out of the crowd. And, you know, it's been pretty amazing just to see everyone here.
When it comes to fan support, the Sioux hockey team knows that they have a special advantage in this neck of the woods.
You know, the one thing that we know as a program, as a team, as coaches, we've got the most passionate fans in the country.
Yeah.
That type of rabid passion brings another element into our rink, and we know we're lucky to have it.
So as the sun sets on these fans, it will soon rise again on another season of hockey in North Dakota. Of North Dakota just recently switched back to the campout method for season ticket distribution. For the previous 4 years, students were able to purchase tickets online. Coach Haxtell says that going back to the ticket campout will give students a chance to participate in a tradition that had been a part of UND for decades. Now the answer to this week's Studio One Sports trivia question. We want to know which Major League Baseball team completed the biggest comeback to reach the playoffs. The answer is D, the Boston Braves, who in 1914 overcame a 15-game deficit from the New York Giants to go on and win the National League pennant, and they also went on to win the World Series. That's the sports. Monty and Amy.
Thanks, Eric. A woman on death row was recently denied parole. What makes her case different is that she has terminal brain cancer. We wanted your thoughts on leniency for prisoners who are dying.
Also, there's nothing better than that new car smell. Some small-town students are finding out if there's such a thing as new school smell. We'll tell you how a tornado misplaced teachers, students, and books for 2 years.
Remember where you met your best friends? Where you discovered your passions? Celebrate the past by supporting UND's future. The University of North Dakota Alumni Association connects you with people who have touched your life. They engage you in the university community and campus events. Help the University of North Dakota grow by becoming involved with your alma mater. The University of North Dakota Alumni Association. Connect. Engage. Grow.
I'm off to class. Me too.
The University of North Dakota is a place where students thrive, where they learn from leading experts, share in discoveries, and create knowledge. Experience our expertise. Creative, innovative, entrepreneurial, spirited. This is the University of North Dakota.
We know exactly what you're looking for.
Because we've already found it.
The Energy and Environmental Research Center in Grand Forks, North Dakota has opportunities available for you. You'll work with a dynamic team of professionals in a variety of programs that have gained international recognition. We offer competitive salaries, an outstanding benefits package, and a place for you to pursue your dreams. To learn more about opportunities at the EERC, visit us on the web.
You're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks.
Back to school can translate to back to early mornings and stacks of homework for many students. In one tiny Midwest town, back to school means a whole lot more.
Students have returned to their studious ways in Northwood, North Dakota. A new school year is underway, complete with new books, new pencils, and for these kids, a new school.
They love being in school. In fact, I had a number of students that said they're still not tired of going to school. You know how kids tire sometimes? It kind of gets old and they're still really enjoying coming.
These young scholars adore their new halls and walls. But the whirlwind that led to the fresh accommodations was not as welcome.
And we had walked down the hallway, the elementary hallway, and there was water over my ankles as my son and I walked down the hall with Mr. Hutch.
It was a walk down the hallway of a school that had just been rocked by an F4 tornado. All of this the night before classes were to resume.
It was really hard to believe that it happened. I think we were all in shock walking around.
With no school to call home, the students and staff looked 8 miles down the road to Hatton, who welcomed their sister school without hesitation.
The oddness of it, we were in portable classrooms, the FIAD and the community center were going inside for bathroom breaks and lunch. It just all became normal for 2 years.
Bonds formed during their stay.
They really built friendships and relationships, and I think the parents did as well.
But I really do hear the kids say a lot that they miss the kids from Hatton.
But soon it was time to go back and put down roots in a once uprooted community.
You know, they just pulled together. I mean, small town, I mean, you can't beat it. They were just, it's one big family.
And now this family has a new place to call home. With photographer Franklin Rojas, I'm Kaylee Nesdal for Studio One.
Plans are underway for a commemorative wall in the new Northwood School Commons area. The wall will be built using bricks pulled from the rubble of the school they lost. A member of the infamous Manson family was recently denied parole. Susan Atkins is serving a life sentence for murders back in 1969. This parole hearing was different than others for Atkins. She is diagnosed with a fatal brain tumor. We want to know your thoughts on whether or not denying death row inmates with terminal illnesses.
The other families of the victims they killed didn't get extra time to spend with their loved ones, so I don't think just because they're dying that they should have the option or the choice to be able to spend time with their families.
If they do have a terminal illness, they should be able to spend their last years, maybe last year or so, with their family members just to reconnect and then to say their goodbyes.
They did something very bad in the community to someone that they should absolutely stay in there would be my thought of that.
There's a few crimes that just aren't really parolable. Regardless of your situation, you kind of gotta serve the term. You gotta pay your dues.
If I was that sick, I wouldn't be able to pay for my own care. So I don't want to pay for their care if they're in the system.
Omega-3 fatty acids are found in ocean fish. These fats are healthy fats that your body could use. Our next guest will give us another reason to add fish to our plates.
Closed captioning for Studio One is underwritten in part by the Listen Center, where meeting friends at Listen is a groovy thing to do and has been since the days of Woodstock. The University of North Dakota Graduate School offers unique opportunities for students who love to keep their eyes on the skies. Atmospheric science students are using advanced radar to see what's happening deep inside the clouds. Students and professors in our space studies program are helping to shape the future of interplanetary travel. Major projects include designing and testing a spacesuit for the mission to Mars. Reach for the skies and beyond with a graduate degree from the University of North Dakota.
Wall Street has come to the prairie through the A. Kirk Lannerman Investment Center at the University of North Dakota. This state-of-the-art facility in the College of Business and Public Administration provides hands-on experience in the world of modern finance. Students learn how financial markets react with lightning quickness to world events. They use cutting-edge technology and real-time data from more than 200 financial markets around the world. The Lanterman Investment Center provides the tools to make a career out of an education.
Size of the woman in the fight is the size of the fight in the woman. Visit onlinecourses.und.edu today.
At the University of North Dakota School of Engineering and Mines, I can experience education that fits my goals.
Become a competitive graduate in a global market and learn in small class sizes where professors are also mentors.
Work in a diverse team and inspire young minds.
Help develop world-class research.
Gain state-of-the-art technical knowledge while building strong business and leadership skills.
And stay connected even after I graduate.
Some researchers say a mineral found in fish may be beneficial to pregnant women, but the Food and Drug Administration warns that ocean fish contain high levels of mercury. Recent studies show pregnant women can increase their baby's IQ by eating ocean fish. Research scientist Nicholas Ralston studies ocean fish and their benefits. Thanks for coming on the show today.
Happy to be here, Monty.
Well, what led you to study this type of thing with fish?
Well, I was aware of selenium metabolism and its importance in the brain. And one of the reasons why I wanted to get into the mercury issue is it's been well known that mercury has a huge binding affinity for selenium. And so it was obvious that if we were exposed to too much mercury, it would get into us, bind our selenium, and make all of those enzymes that our brain cannot live without function poorly or not function at all.
Okay, and well, what is selenium? I've heard of mercury, not so much selenium.
Okay, well, selenium is on the side of your cereal box, or certainly on your vitamins. It's an essential element, just like oxygen, sulfur. If you don't have this, you won't live. All animals that have complex brains have an absolute requirement for selenium. These enzymes do a lot of important functions, like converting the thyroxine into its active form, but probably most important in the mercury issue is they protect against oxidative damage. And we're very familiar with the bad effects that happen when there's too much oxidative damage, and you never want to have that happen in your brain.
Well, what is the relationship between mercury and selenium?
All right, well, mercury, if it's present in too high a quantity, can find the selenium that's in your body, bind to it, and form a insoluble precipitate that does never release the selenium back to do the work that it's supposed to be doing. Now, so the issue about mercury toxicity we're finding is not so much about how much mercury necessarily, but how much mercury in relation to selenium in what you eat.
Okay, so if you have more selenium, it cancels out the mercury?
Yeah, it's more or less that in all of the studies that have shown harm, it's always happened when there was too much mercury, like five times as much mercury as selenium in the food. And of course, we were always assuming that we were being warned about eating ocean fish because studies of ocean fish consumption were causing harm. It was really whale studies. A small group of islands in between Scotland and Iceland called the Faroes, where they eat a lot of whales. Several thousand whales are consumed by this rather small population, so they eat a lot of whale. And this food is really bad for mothers to consume, because five mercuries for every selenium, there's no way that mother can get enough selenium to her baby.
Okay, you mentioned whales. What are some other sea fish that are that have high levels of mercury that you wouldn't want to eat?
Well, one of the other studies that showed harmful effects did involve ocean fish, but a rather unusual type. Large sharks are the only other type of food that we're currently aware of that can have high levels of mercury relative to selenium. All of the other types of ocean fish that we have studied tend to have far more selenium than mercury, which is a very important part of the whole issue. That explains why, even in the study where they were eating whale meat, they found that the more ocean fish the mother ate, the better protected the child was against the mercury that was present in the whale meat.
So they start eating these other types of seafood, sea fish, like tuna would be one?
Tuna is a great one.
Okay, yeah. So then they're getting more selenium, it cancels out the mercury then.
Yeah, and it's more, not. It isn't so much canceling out the mercury, that's a natural way to think about it, but in reality, it's is there enough mercury to steal so much selenium that those enzymes are not allowed to do their function? If they're not doing their function, then there's going to be brain damage. However, if you're eating ocean fish that have plenty of selenium, okay, a mercury can find and bind to selenium there, but you've got 70 more behind it to replace it, so no enzyme is going to go without.
Okay, what about freshwater fish? I mean, we hear consumption advisories for mercury in freshwater fish. Is it the same?
That's a very important part of the issue. We're initiating a study together with EPA where we're going to be looking at the relationship between selenium and mercury in freshwater fish. The issue with freshwater fish is some places do not have enough selenium in the soil surrounding a lake or river to run into that body of water and provide the fish the selenium they need to bind with the mercury or prevent the mercury toxicity.
And we have a map that you gave us, and this is a map of the United States, and it shows selenium levels, and we see it varies throughout the country. So selenium is in soil, so in my garden, I'm growing a tomato in a place that's high in selenium. Is that a good tomato to eat then?
Yes, actually all foods grown throughout the central part of the nation tend to be rich in selenium. America is very selenium rich. That's part of the reason why we're less aware of the selenium issue than many other countries are, because we're so rich in it. But some parts of the nation that are low, the livestock, the farmers know that they have to provide salt blocks for their herds of cattle or else they will die of selenium deficiency.
Okay.
So we veterinarians tend to be more aware of the selenium issue than physicians.
Sure. Well, how hard is it to spread the word about these findings? Because hearing, hey, seafood is great for pregnant women, that's news to me.
Yeah, well, actually, this has been something that over the last few years has been increasingly appreciated by everybody in the issue. All of the most recent studies, we've had much larger studies now where they were looking exclusively at mothers eating normal types of ocean fish, like mothers in Great Britain, about 14,000 mothers. Very good study, very well designed. The people that were throughout their pregnancy, their fish consumption was monitored. The children are now 17 years old. The more fish that the mothers ate during pregnancy, the better the children are performing scholastically, socially, their IQs are improved. The most recent study out on this was in New York. They found that the more fish mothers consumed, the brighter their children are, up to 10 IQ points. So this is huge, very important. We have to get the news out, and FDA is actually on top of this and working assiduously on this issue.
Okay, well, thanks so much for coming on the show. It's interesting research.
Well, thank you.
All right. Well, you're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota. We'll be back right after this.
Studio One is a television show produced by staff and students at the University of North Dakota. Here you actually get to do your own stories and you get to go out and talk to people and interview and learn about the cameras and everything that goes into like a live television production. I mean, it's incredible.
Give it a try. I mean, even if you're not broadcasting, communications major, anything, I mean, it's worth it.
For almost 120 years, graduate education has been a focus at the University of North Dakota, and the humanities has been the cornerstone of our liberal arts tradition since the first advanced degree was awarded in 1895. Today, the graduate school continues to build on the success of this tradition by offering exceptional opportunities in the humanities. Seize the opportunity for an advanced degree in the humanities. Contact the graduate school at UND today.
We know exactly what you're looking for.
Because we've already found it.
The Energy and Environmental Research Center in Grand Forks, North Dakota has opportunities available for you. You'll work with a dynamic team of professionals in a variety of programs that have gained international recognition. We offer competitive salaries, an outstanding benefits package, and a place for you to pursue your dreams. To learn more about opportunities at the EERC, visit us on the web.
Tune in next week on Studio One. Historical landmarks remind us of our past. We'll show you how a resourceful family turned a gift and a church with a historical significance into a successful business. Plus, we'll have other news and entertainment stories for you.
We're going to leave you now with pictures of people enjoying a farmer's market. From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.